Unpacking European Energy Policy. It's my great pleasure to welcome today not only you, but also our keynote speaker, Miguel Arias Cañete, the commissioner responsible for climate action and, of course, energy at the European Commission. So the plan of this morning is that the commissioner will present the key insights from the report, and that was just quite recently, I think, published. Not yet published, but I hear it's a long piece of work. And following the commissioner's intervention, we will have a discussion moderated by Shiban from Platz, which is a energy news outlet. And Georg Zachmann, our senior fellow, will be the first discussant of the commissioner. But of course, we also want to give a chance to all of you to ask questions, make comments to the commissioner and to Georg. So without much further ado, Commissioner, welcome. Thank you very much for coming, and please, the floor is yours.
Is that we are going to decarbonize our economies. When we reached the Paris Agreement, there were many commitments. One of them was to control the increase of temperature between below 2 degrees, well below 2 degrees, and with a view to 1.5. And within the commitments of the Paris Agreement was that the parties were invited in 2020 to present the decarbonization strategies. And that's a universal commitment in the future that will hand down by all the parties of this climate agreement and by the European Union ourselves. So we are trying to develop a framework which is consistent with a commitment with the Paris Agreement of the decarbonization of our economy. It's a good thing that the climate policy and energy policy come together under a commission portfolio, and a vice president also handling many commissioners we will interact in this exercise. And that's why when you see the package, you have seen the leaks, things are changing. So the final product will have some elements that have not in one of the drafted leaks, it's because you have said it has been published. No, it has been completely leaked, but in a provisional way. So we are still under discussions, and we are having discussions within the DG, my cabinet, Vice President Sefcovic, and all the DGs involved. Along this week, we'll continue, and the final product, we will know it on Wednesday, probably, because it's still in evolution. But the whole idea is how we achieve our 40% greenhouse gas emissions targets, our renewables targets, and our energy efficiency targets, which still are not settled, and will be settled by Wednesday, no? So it's pretty important to have the whole picture of this. For this, one of the main elements of fulfilling our targets is that the electricity markets need to decarbonize. And this is the purpose of this exercise. But with current wholesale electricity prices in Europe at the lowest level in a decade and declining, attractive investment to modernize our electricity system poses a real challenge. There are no price signals to invest in the electricity sector at the moment. Utilities are facing major challenge, and development of renewables is curtailed by many bottlenecks that we are seeing in the system. So now we have to make change possible with ambition and determination. And also, for us, the decarbonization challenge offers a unique opportunity for modernization of our economy and the provision of clean energy for all Europeans. The title of the winter package is not anymore winter package. At the moment, it has a different title, which is clean energy for all Europeans, which is very much linked to energy efficiency, to renewables, and to decarbonize our electricity system. This is not wishful thinking, what we want to do, because it's feasible, and it's feasible in a cost-efficient way. Over the period 1990-2014, our GDP increased by 48%, but our emission intensity was reduced almost by a half. So in the past, we have made good progress. In the future, it will be more challenging, because the low-hanging fruits are more easy. The future is more demanding. And also, we have to take into account that in 2015 alone, the European Union saved around 25 billion euros in energy imports, thanks solely to energy efficiencies. But it is just the tip of the iceberg, because it's very clear that if we, instead of a 27%, we go for a 30% target in energy efficiency, we can add 70 billion euros more to our economy, and we are able to create 400,000 new jobs. So one of the things we have to decide, and one of the major decisions is to raise the level of the target of energy efficiency from the 27% going to a more ambitious target. We, in the impact assessment, we model all kinds of them, and there are some preferred options that are currently still under discussion. So we have to make investment flow to sustainable innovative solutions. We might have to go faster, trigger investment, and that's what the package has been designed to unlock our green growth potential across the board. The new renewables directive will create the right conditions for clean energies to thrive and make the European Union number one in renewables again. The new market design, on which I will elaborate further in a minute, will improve market integration and competition, reinforce investment signals, and empower consumers. And the review of the energy efficiency legislation will tap into the energy savings that can kickstart our economy. If we are able to get our act together and do it right, we can unlock a 1% increase of GDP by 2030. We can pump 190 billion euros into the European Union economy, and we can create as much as 900,000 new jobs. So it's a challenge, achieving our targets, but it has results, positive economic results. And that's the clear message. This is not, we are not speaking about costs. We are speaking about opportunities. That's the logic of the package. What happens with the market? The market has to work for everyone, for renewables, for traditional generation, and we have to adapt some rules first. In an electricity market that is going to be dominated by variable renewables and by a more flexible demand, we have to generate the right incentives to foster investment. And we have already done part of our homework by making proposals on how to strengthen the carbon price signal by revising the emission trading system. It's pretty clear that the emission trading system is a major driver for investment, for innovation, and for decarbonization of our economy, for sure. And it's quite sure that we have done efforts to improve the functioning, but the prices are very low. We established the backloading, we have done the market stability reserve, we have a reform underway, and we have the European Parliament, which is making very positive amendments at the moment, even as in a compromise has to be established between the ITRE committee, the ENVI committee, and around the European Parliament. But the signals that the European Parliament is clearly aware that we have to have a more performing emission trading system is very clear, mainly because the position of the Commission is that we have to have a market approach to the carbon markets and not to go establishing prices in a political way as some people want. There are two different models. And during the last days, we have heard new ideas to put border carbon tax adjustments in view of the situation in the United States. One of the things I would like to say here is that coming back from Marrakesh, what I have seen is the universal commitment to go on with ambitious climate targets, with ambitious energy policies in all of the countries that we're meeting in Marrakesh the last 2 weeks. So the commitment to go ahead is universal. The commitment by China, the big emitters, is also universal. So this is a something important, and that's why, regardless of the situation in the United States, the progress must be made in this area. And we have to have a well-functioning carbon market. This is one of the items in which the cooperation with China will be very close in the future. China is launching an economy-wide carbon market, and in the future, the ideal situation will be to link the global markets of the world, and the Commission is proposing to organize a very big conference with China next year on carbon markets, so that we bring together all the countries and even all the states like California who are developing carbon markets together to see how we can improve the functioning of our markets in the future, because this will be the main drivers of investment. What happens in our markets, in addition to emission trading system, is that if prices don't react quicker to reflect changes in variable generation and the shift in demand, there are no price signals, and prices have to rise when demand is high or generation is scarce, and if concentration prices are removed. But also, it also means that demand needs to react to changes in the generation if we have to avoid enormous costs to back up generation. So acting on prices, eliminating regulated prices, giving price signals at the moment, allowing demand response, allowing consumers to be active in the markets, this would be one of the major challenges. And that is why we want to develop a system who rewards flexibility and who brings tangible benefits to European Union consumers. This reform is much more focused on consumers. Consumers who will generate their own energy, consumers who will sell their energy, consumers who will react to price signal, dynamic pricing of contracts is a new world, because we have new technologies which make it possible, but they are not used at the moment. So there is no demand response, mainly because there is no culture in the consumer side to be active in the market. Then we need aggregators, we need DSOs to be more active, and all of this will be in the logic of the reforms. But active participation of consumers and demand response is one of the important things, and that is why we have to promote better integrated short-term markets, because short-term markets, intraday markets, even hourly markets, and the very short distance between the contracts and the delivery of energy is the one thing we need. We have to have flexible generation and renewables very active in the market. So European Union-wide intraday and cross-border balancing markets will be one of the axes of the reform. And we want to stop there, because we will further remove roadblocks to innovation, to also enable the natural development of new energy services, and to open the door to non-traditional actors to the market. We have a very too closed market. We have to open it. It's not easy. There are few resistance by many of the actors, but we have to bring together. And then that brings along, which is the new role of DSOs, the aggregators, how of energy communities. It's a whole different world. We have to make it possible in the future. This will help us respond to the need for growth and investment and create a value in a market that has in the past been close to new business models. But in the end, the deep transformation of the energy system that we are witnessing calls for a wider rethinking of the way we engage with our energy system. And we cannot ignore anymore the new developments that have led consumers or allow them to play an increasing role in the markets, because consumers should be able to make the most of any transition and reduce the electricity bills. Because thanks to technological developments and cost reductions, consumers have to become the real drivers of this energy transition. And every new year, more consumers become active participants in the market at slow pace now, generating renewable electricity on site to consume, store, or sell to the grid. Consumers will play a key role in achieving the flexibility that we need to integrate abundant renewables and to provide quick and efficient demand response. But this won't happen if consumers don't trust the system in which they operate. And right now, they face huge barriers to fully engage in today's energy system. And in many ways, they are not letting get a fair deal for our energy improvement. That is why, as part of our new electricity market design, we will promote measures that empower consumers and that facilitate their active participation in the electricity market. First, we will increase retail competition to improve consumers' engagement, keep consumers' costs low, and ensure all consumers have access to this new service. Second, we will make the grid flexible at both the generation and consumer ends to foster self-generation and demand response so that consumers can adjust their consumption to price fluctuations resulting from variable wind and sun and can benefit from lower electricity prices. And third, we will allow consumers to switch providers more easily, get clearly billing and comparison tools, and reduce restrictions and switching fees. Altogether, these measures will incentivize consumers' engagement with the market, help consumers save money in their bills, and allow them to benefit from new services that add value. But in the end, empowering consumers will mean nothing if energy cannot flow quickly and unimpeded to those places where it's most needed. And that is why, even if some people don't like it, we will promote better regional and cross-border cooperation on energy policies and support schemes to ensure a secure supply of energy to all Europeans. Now, full market integration will require more than simply building new interconnector. Interconnector policy will be a priority for the Commission, but it's not only the physical interconnection. We have other bottlenecks at the moment. And we will no longer try to tolerate situations where bottlenecks are artificially pushed to the border. And we will not accept the existence of fragmented and uncoordinated national measures to remunerate generation capacity. It's very clear that you need to have a movement towards a European framework, more harmonized levels of capacity, remuneration mechanisms, because if we don't do that, it will jeopardize the market and the security of millions of Europeans. An effective market requires a shift in focus from the national to the European level, and that is why we will propose a European framework for capacity remuneration mechanisms to ensure coherence, cross-border participation, and avoid market distortions. And let me also be clear about one thing. One of the elements that we have to take into account is that capacity mechanisms should not be an excuse, should not serve as an excuse to subsidize high polluting generation assets that would counteract our decarbonization objectives. It will have no logic to have the aim to decarbonize our economy and establish capacity mechanisms that not take this into account. So it might, I say might, therefore be necessary to include strict environmental criteria in such mechanisms to avoid giving wrong incentives that might lead to stranded assets as our emission cap gets tighter. And we will also develop a new risk preparedness proposal to guarantee that all member states duly prepare for crisis situations and cooperate with one another to prevent electricity crisis situations. In this way, we will make sure that a secure supply of electricity can reach those that need it most during a crisis. In conclusion, reforming our electricity market should not be seen as an isolated action, but as a cornerstone of our energy and climate strategy. Because as the clean energy transition unfolds before our eyes, we need to be ready to leap and shape it in a way so that all Europeans can reap its benefits. And in this context, I am confident that the legislative packet that we will launch in a week's time will help us to provide the smart and clean energy for all Europeans. It's a complex package. And I think it's a package that has to be assessed when you see the whole picture of the different pieces of legislation, four for the electricity market design, two for energy efficiency directed energy from buildings, the risk preparedness, and the governance elements. So there are eight big elements. It's a big package. And let me also finish with the governance, because it will be a very important part of the package. We cannot achieve our targets, the three of them, the 40% reduction, our four targets, the at least 40% greenhouse reduction emissions, the at least 27% renewables, the 27 or 30, let's see which is the final figure, on energy efficiency, and the targets for interconnection for 2020, the 10 and the 15% for 2030. You cannot achieve that without a strong governance. And that will be one of the important parts of the legislation, because this is a whole package, but in the end, it's how we fulfill the agreements we have made in Paris with 196 other countries. And the governance requires, for sure, national action plans on climate and energy, together, joint, integral. And those have to be also linked with the five-year periods of the Paris Agreement, dynamic raising ambition, for sure. And it will be a good occasion, because at the moment we have more than 50 reporting requirements of member states, different for climate, for energy, with different timetables, with different frameworks, with different systems of information. We have to streamline on a single plan. So we will go for plans that have to be prepared by the member states, not isolated, but also in cooperation with the neighbors. So the elaboration of the plans will be a processing with member states. Will elaborate the climate and energy plans. They will communicate them to the Commission and also to the member states in the region. There will be an iterative process by the Commission, seeing the level of ambition of these plans, and then they will be approved, and by 2019 we will have all the climate and action plans ready. They will have every 5 years to be updated, because the stock taken under the Paris Agreement is also on the 5 years. The first stock taken will be in 2023, and in 2025 it will be the timing which countries may communicate more ambitious NDCs. On the other side, the member states have to make the plan, and they have to communicate 50 years strategies of decarbonization of their economies. The European Union and all the parties of the United Nations have to deliver them by 2020. So it's also logical that member states do their own strategy, because as parties of the Paris Agreement, they have to deliver this mid-century decarbonization strategy, which is accomplished. Now we have our roadmap. But our roadmap between 80% and 95% decarbonization was done, and the absorption of the 2 degrees. Now we are in a new scenario, which is well below 2 degrees, which is much more ambitious. So it's plans, national integrated plans, energy, climate, and 50 years strategies. This will be one of the major challenges of this package for the future. And then the State of the Union report and debate will become very important, because the Commission will make country recommendations, and we follow up in iterative process the fulfillment of this process, and we'll revisit the legislation if the targets for energy efficiency or renewables or emissions are not being achieved at the moment. So it's a complex process, has a strong governance, and I expect that the final product will be the product the European Union needs to fulfill its compromises under the Paris Agreement. Sorry for not being too specific. For starters, we will do in the question time, but I must tell you that the package is evolving, mainly because, as it has been absolutely leaked to all the world, all the lobbies of the world are very active, all the governments are angry, for one reason or another, and we have to have a balanced package. So at the moment, everything is boiling, is coming, and arbitrages within the Commission are taking place also. So it has been a very interesting experience engineering this package, and I have to say that DG Clima and DG Energy have done an impressive work. Vice President Sekovic has coordinated many project teams in order to reach compromises balance. We still are on it, and we will finalize along this week. So I'll try to be more specific afterwards, but when you see the final product, you will understand the logic. And the logic is that we have achieved integrated climate and energy policies within the European Union. Now the Commissioner for Climate doesn't discuss with the Commission of Energy. I am discussing with myself every morning, but I am able to reach compromises myself and then translate the message to the rest of the people who work for me. It's an ambitious package. It's complicated because it's a revolution of change. to integrate renewables will not be easy, because we established our targets, but we didn't think how the market will work, and now we have a market which doesn't work. It requires major changes. It requires cooperation among the state. It requires regional operation centers, and then TSOs don't like it, because everybody wants to keep their own capacity, competences, and not allow other people. If you reinforce Acer, there are national regulators who become amtres. If you establish regional operation centers and Acer has a say, then TSOs become angry. If you give power to DSOs, then TSOs say, what's happening here? So the balance of interest is fairly complicated, and you will understand the difficulties of the package when you see the final product. And let's, and afterward, the implementation with the governance, Vice President Sekovic will have to do a very good job in the State of the Union report and governance process.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much for going through what is indeed a very, very complex package. And also, good to know there might still be some surprises next week.
For sure.
Good to know. Good to know. So now I'd like to hand over to Georg from Bruegel to give some reactions and some comments. Georg.
Okay. Could we put the slides up? Okay. Yes. Thank you very much for coming here to Brussels, to Bruegel. And I would like to give or use my 10 minutes to take a step back and a bit focus on the bigger picture, because I was unable to read through the 1,000 page of leaks this, and I will try to make some simplifications, and please excuse me for that. So, can we have the next slide? Okay, what I would like to do is to start really with the aims of European energy and climate policy. So, what's the three, or I put here four main aims. The first one is we want to stay well below the 2-degree target, and the second one is in terms of competitiveness. So, we want the energy cost in the European Union to be sensibly low, competitive with other parts of the world. I put a second note of competitiveness, which is we want to be good in exporting low carbon technologies, because we have developed some comparative advantage here and we might want to strengthen that. And we want to have a secure energy supply, which is both internal, so the lights shouldn't go off because of technical defaults, but also external. Now, what is the current policies on that? Next slide, please. So there is a complex mixture, so it's a very crowded policy space, having been filled for more than 20 years from all sides. And in terms of EU policies for keeping well below 2-degree target, we have the renewables policy, we have energy efficiency policy, we have the emission trading system, we have the effort sharing decision between member states. So there's a lot of things already being implemented, but we know that this is not sufficient to keep to get to the 40% reductions that we want to have by 2030. In terms of competitiveness, the main tool that has been heralded is the internal market. And as the commissioner mentioned, there are some substantial issues with the internal market functioning nowadays, and there needs to be repair. In terms of competitiveness, I think we are doing relatively limited amounts in terms of innovation policy on the EU level, so there is a set plan for coordination, but the renewables policy itself has been a strong market pull for this technology, but probably more can be done. And in terms of energy security, a lot is about network codes for the security of supply, and in terms of infrastructure, the Commission mentioned that there are also here, again, some room for improvement. Next slide, please. So what does the winter package, as the leak that I saw and quickly skimmed through, essentially adds to that? I think a very important point for me, and that's what has been mentioned last, is the new governance structure, essentially for meeting the energy efficiency and renewables targets. I think it's a completely step change in the way the European Union interacts with the member states. It essentially is, for me, a sort of a copy of the Paris Agreement to some degree, that there is a long-term planning by the individual member states, and there is a pledge and review from the Commission. So it's not this Brussels dictates to the member states what they should do, but it's the member states coming up with plans, trying to be fulfilling them, and the Commission monitoring whether they are on a good track. So it's essentially potential, or for me, it's a recognition of the shift in power in the interaction between the member states and the EU. And probably that's sensible at this point in time, where we have discussions about Brexit, and we have had all sorts of power struggles between the member states and the Commission. In addition to that, the winter package has a number of detailed updates on energy efficiency and renewables policy. We can come to that later, and I think there will be some things to be discussed there. In terms of competitiveness, here I think the Commission is still very much focused on the on its initial tool in the winter package. So it's about strengthening the internal market. The internal market was there, and the Commission tries to strengthen it with new rules on capacity mechanisms, because capacity mechanisms are there in the member states. So the Commission tries to kind of harmonize them with the regional operation centers and many, many other things that are in the market design proposal. The competitiveness part, I haven't seen innovation much addressed in the leakages, and I think that might be a point to be discussed later. And on energy security, I haven't seen any leak on the ESA directive. I hope that there's something in, because I see in terms of interconnector building is currently not working very well. The next slide, please. So does the winter package help to achieve the targets? Well, first of all, the current targets that we have are insufficient to reach the 2-degree target. So our 40% decarbonization is not on a trajectory to reach 80 to 95% decarbonization by 2050. Something needs to be done there, so we need to get stronger here. And it's very Eurocentric, so we cannot save the world. So we have 10% of global emissions in the European Union. If we reduce them by half, we have 5% of global emissions. That's not making a big change in global emissions. So maybe when thinking about climate policy, we should think a bit more global. In terms of competitiveness, in my view, the proposals on the internal market are interesting, often very sensible. It's good upgrades and updates of current policies, but my impression is it's not really the game that we are in. The game is that the member states don't want a market to coordinate investments into the power plant park. And I think what competitiveness for me is about is getting a cost-efficient power plant park and cost-efficient investments everywhere. But before 1990, member states kind of weakly coordinated on an intergovernmental area of what types of power plants they are building. So they talk to each other. There was some coordination of command and control policies. Then the idea was, no, we move to a market. It's much more efficient. We develop a wholesale market, and we develop an emission trading system. And these two things are essentially going to deliver a well-functioning optimal portfolio of power plants throughout the European Union. That is a brilliant idea. It should be able to work. But then the member states didn't like the outcome of those mechanisms. They didn't like that in Germany it was not possible to keep certain types of power plants in the system. In France, you couldn't invest into nuclear if you and in the UK and in Poland and Hungary, for that matter. So member states didn't simply like the outcome of the European market, and they tried to overrule it with national mechanisms. So they invented what have you, contracts for differences, capacity mechanisms, support schemes. So every member state essentially found its own way to support its own technology preference. And we had an overbuilt system. We had too many power plants in the European system. We had the wrong technologies in the wrong places. Now, the Commission says, no, but well, the internal market is still the best thing we can think of. We should try to keep it back. But I'm not sure that's going to work. So I think what we need here is much more talking to the heads of state and governments and come back to an agreement between the heads of state and government that we need some coordination of the power plant park. On innovation, again, I think it's not addressed properly at the moment. And on energy security, I again fear a bit that the member states are unlikely to seize the sovereignty necessary to make the make this European proposals work. So what is the alternative that I would spend 1 minute on? I think in terms of climate policy and in terms of competitiveness or low carbon technology exports, here we can do quite a lot. We can foster investments in low carbon technologies abroad. We are good in developing some of those technologies, and we see that there are still coal-fired power plants being built in India and Africa and everywhere, and we would have the technology to replace those things with clean technologies. That would mean we don't install so much renewables at home where it essentially replaces power plants that have not reached the end of their economic lifetime, but we try to foster exporting those technologies where it makes really a difference in not locking in a high carbon future. In terms of competitiveness, I think the new governance structure for energy and renewables is a good one. I think in terms of talking about coordinating the power sector between member states, we also need a new high-level sector coordination agreement. I will come to that on the next slide, please. So essentially, member states should decide whether they want a joint market that essentially is allowed to drive investments and that they that they agree that they don't want to kind of overrule the market choices. For me, that would mean a European independent system operator. Member states can only exclude technologies in their country, but they cannot promote a specific technology. And essentially, electricity policies become a European thing. Or that we find another mean of coordinating interventions between member states that is currently not taking place. We simply do not coordinate between member states where and which technology we sit into the member states. My third point would be on reducing micromanagement. I'm wondering a bit when reading the 1,000 pages whether all of that is really necessary. So is it really up to Brussels to decide on renewables in district heating and cooling? It's not a European market. Cannot member states do that, especially when we have this governance structure that gives national targets for the member states to achieve in terms of energy efficiency and renewables? Do we still need rules from Brussels to kind of micromanage those things? And a last point that I always bring up is better quality of the modeling and more open and transparent modeling. I think when we are in the new world with the Commission being more of a soft power entity, I think one of the big improvements would be that Brussels really comes up with the reference model, being the fora for discussing and coordinating things, and here a much better model, more open, more transparent stakeholder input would be helpful. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Georg. So we have about 40 minutes or so for questions. Can I just get an idea of how many questions there might be? Raise your hand if you have a question. Okay, well, that's good. I just want to check, Commissioner, do you want to react to what Georg said?
Yes, a little bit. Okay. No, for sure. I understand the logic of your intervention, and that any reform has to take into account all the priorities of energy security, competitive and sustainable energy. That's for sure, and it's understandable. But it's very clear that we have here two problems when you get to this. One is Article 194, in which there are two conflicting elements in 194. On one side, member states are sovereign to define their energy mix. On the other side, the Commission is asked to develop an internal market. How can you develop internal markets harmonized when energy mix can be established with full independence by member states? That was a very political article. When I was appointed commissioner, I spent a lot of time reading the article and trying to understand what were the margin of maneuver. It's complicated. And in regard to the heating and cooling exercise, this is micromanagement or it is needed? It's a subsidiarity element, or we have to deal with the sector in which more savings of energy and more introduction of and less renewable energy is used, because this is a coal, gas power, and sometimes biomass in an animal. So the doubt is how far you have, how intrusive you are when you have such big targets that with individual action of member states will never be achieved. Because the challenge with energy performance, we take the example of refurbishing buildings. The ratio of renovating buildings, which are the most inefficient in the world because all were built when they were not in performance standard for building. They use lots of energy. They are not insulated. They are not double glazed. The standard of renovation is 1% a year. We will need 100 years to renovate the buildings. Are you do you add prescriptive? Do you establish compulsory percentage? No. In the heating and cooling, it's the same story. So it's and it's an ongoing discussion. We haven't solved yet the heating and cooling exercise. We are currently today dealing with that. Eh? So that I told you that the leaks might not be the final product, and there might be more margin of maneuvers to achieve the target. But that's why the governance will become very important. Because if you are less intrusive, and the October 2014 Council was a very peculiar council. That's another thing I studied when I was appointed commissioner. The decision of the October 2014 Council. That was a council extremely prescriptive, very clear on everything. But one of the things they decided is not having binding national targets. And that's a problem. Because if you don't have binding, how do you benchmark the progress towards nothing globally? Then what happens with early movers? What happens with countries like Nordic countries who have lots of efforts on renewable? They have done a lot. Then how we achieve the 27? We ask those who have been early movers to be more ambitious and left 15 countries doing nothing. So are you prescriptive, not are you intrusive? That's a complicated way when you don't have binding targets. Because the problem is we have binding targets in the 2020 strategy, and then the Commission could enforce them. We have an iterative process. We have infringements. And what was the outcome? That we are on target. We will deliver our targets on renewables, and we probably, on energy efficiency, might be a little bit more complicated, but we will be on very near our target on 2020. They were binding targets. Now, they are not binding anymore, and even at the European level, energy efficiency is not binding. So how we can achieve ambitious climate goals without this element? And then how we work in the market when member states don't want to be coordinated sometimes. We have done the gas supply regulation. It's ongoing on the parliament. We are seeing what's happening with the regions there in the co-decision. So I know there's the discussion, but we have to convince the member states that they cannot act at national level with the challenge we have. They have to coordinate regional. And for risk preparedness and electricity, it's very clear what's happening. See what's happening in France with the nuclear plants at the moment and the rising in demand. You have to coordinate with your neighbors. And this is something which is not a major crisis at the moment. No? But that's what that shows is, because you say, well, member states should take, and the heads of government should take a decision. You imagine the decision they took in October 2014. No binding targets. Let this go, very prescriptive on emission trading system. The caps were established and they were settled at 2.2, the annual reduction factors. It was very complicated, the council. So within that framework, the Commission has to weigh as ambitious within the one out of 194. And that explains that the product, maybe I appreciate very much the Bruegel papers, one of the papers I read when I became commissioner of the challenge this commission had in different sectors. But the challenge in reality is how you cope with it. Because you say, well, I will put you an example, one of the problems we have on the table. Bidding zones or price zones. The logic is doing it at European level. But what happens when you have to divide a bidding zone within a country, within the north and the south of Germany? You say, is Israel going to take the decision? We'll have a political impact. It's complicated, the problem. So within that constraints, we try to be as ambitious as possible.
Okay, thank you, thank you. So we had some questions in the room. There was one at the back. I think there's a mic. Well, we'll take a couple. We'll take here and the gentleman here first, and then we'll take another round. Go ahead.
Good morning. Alessandro Bartelloni, Fuels Europe, the association representing the refining and marketing industry in Europe.
Fuels Europe.
Representing the refinery and marketing industry in Europe. Can I ask the Commissioner a direct question? So if, as we hear, to reduce the carbon content of fuels in transport, the Commission has chosen the option to impose a target on renewable in transport. What will happen after 2020 of Article 7A of the Fuel Quality Directive?
Okay, and there was another question here in the front row. Are you the same? You? Yeah. We'll get the next. We'll be in the next round. No, it's you. Okay. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Jamie Tarleton, working at the European Parliament. My question is, if the United States were to leave the Paris Agreement, what impact do you think that might have on our energy and climate policy?
Okay. Commissioner?
Well, the first one was Article 7, you meant, of the Energy Efficiency Directive?
No, of the Fuel Quality Directive.
On transport, we established an obligation who will go from 1.5 to 5% in 2030, more or less. At the moment. That's what I recall from the papers I read. And also, we are doing another thing, because we are substituting food-based first-generation biofuels by second-generation biofuels, phasing out ones and phasing in the others. The level of phasing out, phasing in is to be discussed. The amount, the percentage for advanced biofuels, and the definitions of advanced biofuel, because it's another game, no? Mm-hmm. But the purpose of the Commission will be, first, that there will be a transport obligation of incorporating, and then the quality of the biofuels, it should be advanced biofuels in the future. Here is an ongoing debate, because we have two options. We could say we stop first-generation biofuels from 2020, and we go for advanced biofuels. But that will be against people who have made investments and under the European regulation, or we make a slow phase down as technological advancement permits us to develop advanced biofuel, because this is a conversation. This is one of the items we are currently discussing: the definition of advanced biofuels, the percentage, and that's what's not settled at the moment. So this is for today, one of the elements for today. You can imagine that the Nordic countries are very keen on it, and also the sustainability criteria for biomass and all the forest associated management policies for it. The United States. In Marrakesh, we went to a COP to implement the COP. We did our job, but in the atmosphere, what was there is what the incumbent president, the next president of the United States, will decide on climate change in view of some declarations during the political campaign and the tone of his first speech after he had won the elections, and the decisions he's currently taking in different positions he's appointing. No? For sure, the United States is the second world emitter. You were mentioning that we were meaningless. I am going back to that. They are 15% emission. What is the impact? It will depend on the American economy, because one is the decision of the federal government and what's happening on the ground. Clean energy is a job creating exercise. During the crisis, in the clean energy sector of the European Union, in the aftermath of the economic, 900,000 jobs were created in this sector. So this is a growing sector all over the world. And you see what's the action that's happening in the United States at federal state level, what's in California, what are the people, what are the mayors of all the cities, of the 40 big cities in the United States, the 40 mayors doing. So it's the impact will be, I don't know the decision they will take, but I think that if it's an administration which is concentrated in Joseph growth, climate change policies cannot be eliminated by presidential decision from day one, or they cannot withdraw easily. They did it in Kyoto. So they did it, and it wasn't a COP in Marrakesh. There was a COP in Marrakesh, and they went out of the Kyoto Protocol. Right? And they had to come back. And they had to explain to the global community when they went out all the consequences of that. We continue in Kyoto with action, the European Union, in the European countries. We are the ones who have, binding committees. We have enforced Kyoto. We have achieved the targets of Kyoto. And we have developed a very competitive renewable sector because 30% of the patents and renewables belong to European companies. And I agree with you. Innovation is not in the package. That doesn't mean that energy and climate and climate action and innovation, we are dealing with Commissioner Moedas very closely to develop a strategy very important to develop disruptive innovation in technologies and also in storage. Because within, in order to develop these flexible markets and this demand response, investment in innovation in storage is one of the utmost priorities we are currently dealing with. So we mentioned innovation, but we have the set plan and the set in our strategy, which we are considering in addition to this package. But we will. It's not something we have forgotten, because we are streamlining and the Horizon 2020, the package for climate action is very complex. Also, in our development aid, we are also concentrating climate change policy. And it's true, in one of your presentations, that the impact the European Union has is not only domestically. Is in our development aid, the investment we do developing the energy sector in developing countries have to be climate change oriented. So we cannot develop old-fashioned technologies, polluting technologies. Our development support aid should concentrate in areas competitive with renewables in those countries. And that's something we have a very good coordination also with Commissioner Mimica on the development action plans that we are doing. And the new EPSI, the new external development fund that we are creating, will mobilize around 44 billion euros, and we have two platforms, one in the neighborhood, one in Africa. It has a climate change component very, very clearly, so that development aid will concentrate in these new clean technologies. Africa is a continent in which there are 700 million people without access to energy. That the problem there is access, and this is a good opportunity to give the access with new technologies, and for European companies will be important. So my assessment is, let's see what happens, let's be cautious, but there will be action in the United States in climate action. We will not be alone, as you say, well, we are 10%, we are meaningless, the American may go out. No, the action in the United States in climate action will be. Carbon markets will be in California. Other federal governments, sub-federal governments will also come along from in the States on this area. And I expect, I don't know what the decision the president may take, but I know what the business community will say. And one of the lessons we learned in Marrakesh is that the side events, the involvement of non-state actors, of business in the global energy revolution is very clear. The importance is what the side events, when you showcase the best practices, what business are doing, how are they supporting developing countries. And one of the things we are doing is capacity building in developing countries to implement the INDCs, the or intended measures. And in that capacity building, one of the messages is you have to fulfill your targets with renewable energy, developing clean technologies, and that is one of the elements that will be there.
Thank you. So the definition of advanced biofuels, that could be one of the new things next week, something to look forward to. And
you have all kinds of things depending who gives you the paper,
exactly.
Who loves you.
Exactly, and you know, if we can't deal with the US president, we can perhaps deal on a state level with individual states. There were some more questions. I'll take, Mark, gentleman here, and the gentleman in the middle as well.
Siobhan, thank you. Mark Johnston, comment, two questions. Comment is that I don't think the commission can blame the summit 2 years ago for not adopting national objectives when the Commission in the same year never asked for that. I appreciate you are not a member of the Barroso Commission, but any incoming Commission has to accept that it inherits the errors and omissions of its predecessors.
I'm not blaming anybody. I'm just pointing out what the outcome.
Okay, well, I think the history is also important. Two questions on subsidies, since we're at an economics think tank, and thank you to Bruegel too. First is, how can you justify new subsidies to old coal plants? When you were speaking, you emphasized the word might. The proposals next week might contain conditions that might mitigate against that, but so far, That's part of what you get with capacity payments. I decode might to mean Commissioner Vestager is treading on your toes on this, which is why it's not settled. But you're right, in the principle you stated, it would be embarrassing for the union to have rules that both charge for pollution and subsidise those polluting plants at the same time. So, you know, essentially, why is that not fixed yet? And the second question also on subsidies. After the UK and Hungarian new nuclear case decisions, is it fair to say that nuclear power is exempt from market rules? Thank you.
As you know, the competition cases are case by case decisions that takes the competition authorities, and in the Hinkley point it was thought that for reasons of security of supply, the package was balanced. It was done in the previous commission. I don't know what this commission would have said under the circumstances, but that's a given. No, that was taken a decision, and it's already there. On the other question, important. I say might, because I have learned to be prudent. But my own position is very clear. It has no logic if you have this challenge of global warming, which is decarbonizing our economy, because some people may like the world, some people may not like it, but we have to do it. And we actually have a roadmap, which comes from 2011, I think, in which we established that we would decarbonize by 95%. And that was 2011, before the October Council, that I'm not blaming anybody, I'm just saying that they were not binding, and they are much more difficult to implement, very, very clear. I am just saying that I have two hats. When I have binding commitments, I have another, when I don't have them. And the logic is a different logic of governance. In the past, it was the Commission directly, infringements, and that's the case. Now, it's an iterative process, also. But my own position is you cannot go for 40% greenhouse gas reduction, at least domestically, as we have. And establish that when you come to something as delicate, with something which is a last resort, which is capacity remuneration schemes, to say, well, we don't take into account the level of emission, the CO2 factor. That's my position, is we should take it into account, and we have to limit. But as I am cautious, and the package is not ready, I can tell you what I tell. That's what I use, might. But if in my own position, my thinking is we should. But the problem is this is a collective decision. This is a complex one, and we have to take a decision with all the elements on the table. And as until the package is finished, I will not be, how to say, very firm in my declarations. Because I have seen many discussions within the Commission in these last 2 years, and I know that things may change for the better sometimes, and sometimes not so for the better, but I'm prudent at this stage. But I say the concern, and I think that under the G20, we have to next year to take, with this commitment we have on the table, decisions on phasing out fuel subsidies. I seem to recall that in the European Union, I don't remember, but it was more than 100 billion, someplace I have the figure about it, because more than 117 billion as a whole in the energy and in the transport we have in both of them, and it's some decision we have to take. And in a time when we have low energy prices, in a scenario, is this the right time? Well, they're increasing now, but it has been the time to take the decision. But let's see what happens, no? But gas supplies, gas is in the future. This is the right time to take the decision. Anyway, we have to take because our climate target that we have accepted. But it has all the logic. We cannot dedicate. And the countries who have taken the brave decision to do so, they have performed economically better. Coming back to the modeling, because I forget, for sure the modeling can be better improved. The Commission wants to be transparent and to do that the reference scenario. And we have a challenge because with the modeling, because we have to develop, we will have to start thinking on the mid-century strategies for 2020, And then the Commission has been committed to do an economic and social impact assessment of this challenge. And that requires some very sophisticated modeling in order to convince the public opinions of the feasibility on one side and how you can take the measures to so that the social dimension is taken into account, because it's very clear. And that economic and social balance must be kept in, and we have to have a very sophisticated modeling to assess the consequences of your movements and the social message you also have to take to have a reasonable balance.
Okay, thank you very much. So far I've got the energy efficiency, things that might be a surprise next week, the energy efficiency target, the definition of biofuels, and something to do with capacity mechanisms. So
there
that's
can
all
be
good
much
to know.
More surprises. Don't put doors to the countryside.
I think, can we take three? There were three questions I saw could be waiting. So this gentleman, we'll take three questions.
Just yeah. For sure.
So this gentleman.
I don't know if you were able to get three answers, but
I know.
But
I'll try. And the chap in the back and this lady here, they were all first. So go ahead.
Nicola Melchiotti from Enel. First of all, congratulations for the package. Actually, it looks
Wait to see it.
No, but it looks very comprehensive. It's a very good place for discussion, and we hope in these final hours it will not change dramatically on the most important points. My question is on governance. You talked about this new approach in which member states present their plans, and their plans are put together, and the Commission jumps in case of need. Can we expect the Commission to take an additional step and develop a real energy strategy, maybe coupled with a real European industrial strategy? Or your role will be limited to put things together, see how they work, and then jump in only when needed? Thank you.
Okay. And there was a question, a gentleman at the back there.
So good morning, Quentin Dulles from BASF. I would like to ask, what's your target for buildings? Because you know that buildings represent a high share of energy consumption, CO2 emissions as well. You can see buildings emitting CO2 behind you. You said that the renovation rate is too low, and we know that for the transition you want to a decarbonized economy, if we don't reduce drastically the energy demand of buildings, then energy will be more expensive for this transition, will be more expensive too for everyone, for consumers, but also for industry. So what's your target for building? Do you just want to decarbonize the supply? So you said electricity will be decarbonized through the just switch to electric heating, or should they also reduce their energy demands? Thank you.
Okay, and then this, the lady here.
Hi, my name is Sarah from Wind Europe, the European Wind Energy Association. My first question is on the national plans and governance, and I was just curious because you said that countries are supposed to share the plans with their neighbors and everything. I was wondering whether this is compulsory, voluntary, whether the neighbors have an obligation to answer to. I mean, I was just wondering if this is going to be effective, if the countries are on board, or if it's going to be just a factor for delay. And then the other question would be about one of these leaks of the package. So it seems that priority dispatch for large-scale renewals is going to be removed. And I mean, I can understand that there's an economic argument here because renewables are pretty cheap and everything. But still, there's a big political commitment. So why would you remove priority dispatch?
So that's the first one was on governance. And,
on the governance side, what we say is that member state will prepare the national the draft national plans based on common requirements, including with regional and public consultations, and they have to submit to the Commission. The Commission will assess the national plans, the draft that they have submitted, and will ensure that other member states commend them. So the idea is the national plan is done by the member state on its own. It's sent to the Commission. Other member states can make comments. And then the Commission will issue recommendations. It's taking into account the national plan, the comments of the neighbors who are influenced, and the Commission will make the recommendations. So it's this type. is this type of governance scheme. Right? So this is the idea. And then once the plan is adopted, they have to be implemented, and then they also will have influence, because there is one piece of legislation, which is the risk preparedness, which is also basic, and all the elements of the risk preparedness have also to be taken account if member states have the plans are in compliance with the risk preparedness directive, because it's also an element of importance, which involves regional cooperation for sure. The element of regional cooperation is also in that directive very active.
Can I just check, when you say the Commission will make recommendations, will the member states have to?
They will have to utmost follow it.
The utmost, they have to do their utmost.
I think the word is utmost in the wording at the moment. I don't know if it's the last. They should utmostly follow it. It means it's a reasonable process. That is, they are sovereign to do their national plans, okay. But I think it's in the interest of everyone to follow the recommendations. The Commission will not make silly recommendations, for sure. They will be balanced, they will be homogeneous, and they will have the same logic for the 28 member states, taking into account the capabilities and the peculiar circumstances of all of them. But it's not that they have to it's not the Commission drafting the plans.
Okay.
Because that would be against subsidiarity, against proportionality, against best legislation, against everything. On the elements of the buildings, we have to. What's the here? You have to see the logic. If we go for a 30% or a 30% energy target, half of the additional savings needed to be achieved will come from the extension of Article 7 of the Energy Directive after 2020. So the obligations to deliver to save 1.5 HCF for final cost of the sales to final customer will be enforced in that way. But the other half should be achieved by the combination of two elements: the energy performance of building directive on one side, and the energy labeling and eco design measures another. Because one of the other elements of this package is the working plan for the eco design, in which new products, with all the debate that new products have, but the impact they have, and the energy performance of buildings. For sure, here we also want to double the rate of renovation to 1% a year, at least to 2%, and see which are the elements we can introduce in this, and to prioritize within this package social activity in social housing and in related to most vulnerable consumers, because we see if we do our right, put our act together, the impact that we can have with the energy performance of buildings, take out of poverty between 500,000 and 3 million households. At the moment, we have 23 million households, which is 11% of the population, which who are in the risk of energy poverty. And this, and acting through the energy performance of buildings with the actual regulation that we have on the table, we can achieve a big reduction for sure. Here, the what we are considering is in the energy performance, we're doing many things, because we are simplifying updated provisions, we are integrating the long-term building renovation strategies with a 2050 focus, and we are doing something which is important for me, if it is in the final package, which will support the deployment of about 5 million electric vehicle recharging points, which is promoting the rollout of recharging for new and major renovated non-residential buildings, and for all residential buildings, non-residential after 2025. In the residential, it's only cabling, it's not charging points, it's just the cabling in order to make it feasible in the future. And we will introduce some elements as a smartness indicator for buildings and so on.
So just on the buildings, the idea is you do want to reduce energy demand in buildings for directly, sure, for and sure. You also want to push away from fossil fuels in buildings too.
As much as we can, and then you are getting into the heating and cooling in buildings, and then you come back to the heating and cooling, and how intrusive you can be in the heating and cooling, and the use of renewables in the heating and cooling sector. Everything in the energy interlink. Priority of dispatch is one of the big questions. If you want a market which is flexible and which is a real market, you cannot have priority dispatch for a single technology, because then you don't have the smart. But on the other side, if you want to develop that technology, you have to have priority access. One thing is priority dispatch, one thing is priority access, and one thing is curtailment. So we will make sure there is no undue and justified curtailment, that there is no undue limits to priority access, but on priority dispatch, we have to reflect on how we make the market more flexible, being reasonable, because there will be a grandfathering. All the ones who are already there with priority, they will remain, but in the future, it will not be needed, and it will not be enforced. Also, for small installations, we may keep it, and for technologies we are not developed. Okay? But for PVs, at the moment, it hasn't got the same logic. It's one of the controversial issues of the reform. We have to explain it very closely. But we have to differentiate priority dispatch, priority access, curtailment. And curtailment, priority access will remain for renewables, for sure. And priority dispatch will be much more limited. There will be exemptions to the rule of eliminating it. And also, we will be a grandfathering of the actual people so that we make a transition without retroactive changes. That's not the negative issue, because one of the things we want is to avoid retroactivity in the frameworks of support scheme in the future, to avoid giving contradictory signals to investors that you can change the regulations and disincentivize investments. So we try to make a balanced proposal, a balanced package, and I thank all the comments made by my friends of Venner. But wait to see the final package, because everybody wants something. And the difficulty of the package is everybody, if what his main interest is not well reflected, he has the whole package. And I think it's not fair. You have to see the whole package as well. As a whole, it's just a big step forward to what we have at the moment. For sure, there will be next package, if there's not a ceremony package, and this one, and there will be more packages, because at the moment, we have a 40% target, but if you see our roadmap of the carbonized economy, we don't go for 40% in 2030 to 80% in 2050. There will be intermediate steps in 2040, and in 2025 there will be a raising of ambition. There will be another one 5 years later, so this is going to be a progressive way. And I come back to the idea. At the moment, because we have been active strategy, what's the role of the Commission in this exercise? For sure, member states are doing themselves national climate strategies. The last one, Germany, was presented last week, no? And other countries are. But the European Union, first of all, is a party of the Paris Agreement and of the Convention. It's also obliged to make the European strategy. And it also has to see the cumulative impacts of the different national strategies in a joint exercise to deliver the needed frameworks to make it possible the advance to the target. So we will deliver our own strategy, and that's why we need the modeling sophisticated, and I take very seriously the remarks you make about the reference scenario, transparency, and the complicated modeling we are using, mainly in the primes, but other things that we use for this exercise.
Thank you. I wonder if we can just squeeze in one last question from Andreas there.
Thank you, Chair. It's Andreas Walstad from Interfax Europe. You mentioned linking the ETS with schemes in California and China. I was wondering if you could maybe expand a little bit more on that.
Well, the idea is the following. We have developed our European carbon market. We have also the carbon market in Switzerland. Not so far away, it's not in California. The idea in the future is whether we can develop carbon markets in a way that they will be easily to interlink them. One of the exercises we did in Paris is to see if we could agree to a global carbon price, mm-hmm. just to float the idea in my bilaterals with the with the big emitters. Say, the ideal situation is a global carbon price. It's a level playing field, it's a signal for everybody. We all can go about the same routes. Now we are developing different carbon markets with different elements who make you arrive at different prices. No? And we have the ideas of the caps and floors, the corridors, and all kinds of ideas. But mainly, there are people who have gone for a market approach. And we sit together and we analyze how we are developing our markets, which are the differences and the similarities, how we can have convergence in the future, and how we can link the markets in the future. We'll have a global market, which is the idea, because as we, you have to read the decision, a global carbon price in the future. If you do it at a climate convention, you have to do it by unanimity. Imagine if even if Nicaragua doesn't like it, you don't have the thing. And it's a good experience I have learned in international talks. When we arrived to Paris, everybody thought, no, India is going to be very difficult. And I said, well, expect what happens with other people in Latin America. They may prove more difficult in the end. Those were the stumbling block in the final hour of the decision. No. So unanimity makes very difficult to have a global carbon price agreed within the climate change convention or within the Paris Agreement. Then we have to go by coordination. And the idea is the more similar our market is to the Chinese, then the more level playing field we'll have. So that's what we are trying is to organize a big conference to join experience. We have some pilot programs to show our Chinese friends how we have delivered our market, the problems we have found, the mistakes we have made, and how not to make them in the future. And we have very good cooperation skills, but we have to enlarge them because there are current markets in Korea, there are in California, there are in other places, and we have to make carbon markets that work together with some degree of convergence. We have to explore that avenue, and I think it's very positive to talk, to have a dialogue, and to be constructive together.
And just one final question on that then. What do you think a global carbon price might be?
First lesson, say something on prices when you have responsibilities as commissioners.
Okay.
First lesson. Okay. Second, if you see the modeling of our impact assessment on DTS, you have an answer there, but I will not give you the answer.
Okay.
I have become prudent at 66 after being imprudent until 64.
Okay, well, thank you so much, Commissioner Cañete, for coming down today. Thank you, Gabe, for your comments and reactions. We'd like to thank the speakers.